the fluffing.
This is right. Fluffing.
Right. Neil. I love how you step over the line sometimes. Great.
Sometimes.
said the bird talking about taking a dump in the chip shop. Anyway, moving on. Hello, everybody, and welcome to this week's episode of Ferguson, Harrington, Hawks.
I'm Ferguson.
I'm Harrington.
And I'm Hawks.
Here we are again.
That was a bit posh, wasn't it? Shall I do it a bit more?
Yeah,
do it. I'm Hawks.
I'm Hawks.
No, it doesn't become you.
Hawks.
Have you ever played a gangster, Chesney?
No.
I think you'd make quite a good gangster. You could be the nice gangster. You know, the one who's nice, yeah. And you go, oh, he's nice. What's he doing being a gangster? And then he stabs you. And then smiles. That could be you.
Yeah, I could do it. I think it would be co-starring Ray Winston.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
Who is actually nice. Who is actually...
Have you met him?
Yes, I have. Properly nice bloke.
Yeah.
Like,
I've heard lovely
nice.
Things about
yeah.
Ray. And he's also a West Ham fan, which makes me very happy.
There you go. Do you know, it's kind of... Nice might be our theme for this thing. Or maybe it's not. Do you have a quote for
us,
Neil?
Our quote today from our guest... is by an American cultural anthropologist, Margaret Mead.
Oh, nice. Mm.
And the quote is, "Never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world. Indeed, it's the only thing that ever has."
Oh, indeed. I like that.
So now our Marge, I tell you, she loved the quote, did our Marge?
Did she?
Oh, my God, they're everywhere.
She's full of them.
I mean, yeah, I can go to a page of about 45 of them right now. You'll be pleased to know I won't.
Sorry, our lovely guest, we don't have time for you today. Neil has 40 quotes for us to digest.
She loved the quote, did Marge? And also, she was so dedicated to anthropology that she got married 3 times.
Oh,
so that is someone that is very committed.
Yeah. Right.
To her
to
work.
The study of humans.
If she wasn't committed then, she would be after three marriages.
That's one less than me, actually. That's one less than me. So, yeah, fair play to her.
Have you been married 4 times? You've not been married 4 times.
Well, Karen is referred to as Mrs. Harrington the Fourth.
Is that
really?
Actually real? You actually have been married 4 times?
No, I married 1 and 2 and 3 I didn't marry, and Karen's number 4.
Wow.
Did you hear the shame in his voice there, Tessie?
You've got to look on the bright side. At least my mum's got a great hat collection, OK?
Yeah, right.
So, you know, every cloud.
Who knew you were the Elizabeth Taylor of Ferguson Harrington Hall?
Anyway,
absolutely.
Back to...
Absolutely. And all while under the stairs.
That's right? Unbelievable. All that action.
Back to our margin of quotes, right? No, but it's an interesting quote because... It's become a motto that many organisations and movements have adopted. And some people even sign it off on their emails.
What, that quote?
Yeah.
Say it again for me. For me and the listener. Me and the listener.
You
and me.
Never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world. Indeed, it's the only thing that ever has. Our Marge.
You know, that totally refers back to story too, right? Like, one of the things that we say in story is that story is there to prolong the species, right? That
right.
It's the passing over of information. And in fact, Mark talks about how when people work together, that's how change happens. So, like, even when the wheel happened, right, where they were like, oh, what is a wheel? Like, somebody did a rolly thing.
Whoa.
Then someone else would come along and go, what's that? And they go, well, I don't know what it's called. It's a thing. It's a rolly thing. And they're
thing.
Like, wee. And he goes, yes, wheel, right? And then they decide to talk and then they progress it, right? Yeah, that's it. That's happening.
Exactly how it happened.
Yeah. No, but I want to go back to that day. Ooh, there's a wheel.
Wee.
Can you imagine being there that day?
Right?
Oh, your mind would be blown.
Look at it go. Wee.
But I do think about that sometimes. Like when I was back in Scotland at one point and on the train, and I can't remember what was happening. I think it was quite a dark time family-wise. Like I think my mother was very sick or something like that. And I was thinking about how dark the world can be and how lonely it can be. And I looked out and there was all these things that just said, absolutely no, it's not. Right?
Yeah.
And even down to the things like there was like sheep in a field, right? Mm-hmm. And I'm like, oh, somebody looks after those sheep. And then somebody makes the food for the sheep. And then like the whole thing of when you look at anything, you see the community behind it. And I'm like, and I'm sitting on a train. And there must have been a guy that invented this train, and then somebody else that drew it up, and then a whole load of people who built it. And then there's all the people who clean it. And then the guy who's going to come by and do the ticket. Like, actually, we do exist as communities. We are in communities, but sometimes I think it's easy to feel lonely and isolated. But I like that quote, because you're like, actually, no matter what you do, there's a whole team of people involved in the making of it. And everything.
I kind of saw it as like protesting and things like that, where are the things that make the difference.
Yeah.
You know, when people get together and...
Let me just chip in there for you, Ches, and then you can carry on. So a description of it. Real change comes from the ground up, not the top down. The public people outnumber the government representatives we send to do our bidding. And if and when something is considered important enough to fight for, we stand up, make ourselves heard and affect change. So, yeah. That's exactly how you saw it.
Yeah, I guess so. Like, you know, the people, groundswell, you know, if it isn't for us, the people, we the people, we can make a difference, you know, if we get together and protest or whatever it is that we need to do. I guess that's how I saw it.
Have you ever been on a good protest?
I did kind of a little bit with the Black Lives Matter protests through the pandemic, you know, because Casey, my eldest, was very, very kind of heated about that and wanted to be involved and wanted to go to these. So, so I kind of a little bit there. But have you guys, have you been in the middle of anything? Like...
Come round here waving your placard at me, love, I tell you.
Yeah, have you ever been on any, Neil?
No. Oh, did you get your sleeves rolled up? Did you get your gloves on?
Yeah, I used to go to them. Well, because I do believe that the only way that you can say that you don't like something is by saying that you don't like something. You don't go, I don't like that. Like, no, I don't like that. I did
That's how you make a difference.
Yeah, by saying that's not appropriate. It's boundaries. I think that might be the thing, when you put down your boundaries. You go, no, boundaries crossed. I have to say, politically, I don't understand why... I mean, I'm going to get into trouble. Listener, it's okay. I'm on that kind of
mood today. She's going politics.
But I don't understand why people are not protesting more in the UK right now, where it's evident that it's just like one guy going, I'll do things how I want to. And me and all my pals from Eton, we all agree that I can do whatever I want. And I've got lovely hair. And you just shut up and don't put your heating on. And that's how things are going to be.
Did you see that fantastic protest? My favourite protest I think I've ever seen of all of these guys got together with the Boris Johnson heads. And they're all having a party. Like, it was just the best.
Have a party.
Oh, my goodness. But I agree.
In fact, a lot of the way that I started when I left drama school, I did a double act. And a whole load of the things that we did as the double act were like these kind of meetings of people. Like, we did things for CND and we actually were part of the unions. We represented.
I was going to say unions, because that's what this is all about, really.
About the poll tax. Coming in, so we travelled down to, Maggie Thatcher, milk snatcher, right? There was a lot of protests then, yeah.
Oh, there were, yeah. And the miners, do you remember the miners' protests?
Yeah, I do. I definitely do, yeah.
Arthur Scargill, yeah.
But I also think that in modern terms, how you can see it is like in the just giving thing. Or even, I was reading this morning, I don't know if it'll change things, but it's probably wrong to laugh at it. I'm sorry, listener, I'm very controversial today. The 2 million people have signed a petition that says Amber Heard must not be allowed to be in Aquaman 2.
Wow.
And I was like, man, if we could get 2 million people to, like, protest about anything, that would be awesome, right?
But that?
Well, I get the point of it. And I think what it says about people is that we relate to individual stories. You know, we relate to the individuals. Mm. It's why Boris is getting away with so much shit, to be honest, where they go, he has parties and yes, he doesn't care that I can't go to my grandma's funeral, but he doesn't mean it.
Yeah,
right?
Exactly.
He's misunderstood.
He can't even do his hair.
Look at him. Yeah. What about you, Neil? What did you take the quote to mean? Or were you too busy researching and writing letters to all your ex-wives?
and going through the 40 quotes that he'd read from
Marge. No, it was interesting
Marge.
How it's become a motto for many organisations and movements. That was the bit. And I just sort of, it took me to looking into Margaret Mead, yeah, the way I interpret it is exactly what this is, explanation is. Real change comes from the ground up, not the top down.
It'd be interesting to see what our lovely guest says about the quote and why he chose that.
Quite a mark of our guest today, isn't it, really, I think?
I love him. He's one of the people that I met when I first came to the US. And Los Angeles is an interesting place. There are a quota of people in LA, and you may agree with me, Chesney, yeah, who would rather look pleasant than be pleasant. They'd rather look helpful than be helpful.
Gosh, yeah.
And actually, this guy, he's just such a good guy. If he can help you, he will help you. Like, even because I messaged him and said, dude, can you do this thing? And he's like really busy, but he was going, okay. When do you need me? Like, just, he's a properly good guy.
I tell you what, we'll check in with him after the break.
Awesome.
Okay. More on that later, because I have something to say about that.
I love a bit of editing. Yeah, great. Okay. Here we go, team. Is it possible to be successful and also be a nice guy? Some of you say no. I say yes. And if you want to argue about it, here's the proof. 25 years working in TV as a writer, producer, and now executive producer on one of the biggest shows in the world. I am, of course, talking about NCIS, guys.
Woohoo!
Ooh, I say.
It's Scott Williams on our podcast.
Yay! Scott Williams! Hey, listener, we've just been having an argument, me and Scott, about, because I tell you, he properly is a really nice guy, and he's like going, no, I'm not a nice guy, I'm going to talk to you about that later. So I'm like throwing it at you, go, Williams, tell me that you're not a nice guy.
You know, the imposter syndrome kicked in, so when you asked me to do this podcast, first I thought it was going to be above your garage and, you know, in person, yeah, which I was like, I couldn't wait to see you again. And so nice to meet the other two lads here, I of course listened to the other podcast because I thought, you know, maybe this is, you know, am I smart enough? Am I good enough to like join this group?
Gosh.
And you know, a good 10 minutes into the first listen, I'm like, I can totally. I'm good enough. I'm smart enough, and doggone it, people like me. Is the old Al Franken saying? I don't know, but
absolutely.
Yeah, I love that you guys do this, and I'm delighted to join you. So thanks. I'll try to be nice. I'll try to prove that introduction correct.
You don't have to try. What I want to talk about is that we asked you about the quotations, right? And the reason that we've asked people to give quotes or sayings or proverbs or whatever is that often when we bring guests on, we talk about, or we have an idea of who they are through what they do. But with the quotations, we get an idea of who they are by what they feel, what they live by. And the quotation that we chose, actually, and you gave us lots, which is very you. It's very you, and I'll tell you why it's you. Don't you try talking. Do you think you're the guest or something?
Yeah, you've got no chance, Scott. Come on.
This is why Lynn loves me, because I yield. I back
We off. All do, Scott. We all do. We've learned.
She loves yielders. Yes.
I do. I definitely do. How do you think I got Mark? He just surrendered in the
He's
end.
A good,
he was like,
he
okay.
just rolled over.
Right.
It's like, okay.
Sorry, no, lovely, you were saying?
I thought it was very sort of symptomatic of you in a way, or a good example, in that you gave us lots of quotes. And I think that's something about you, which is you're generous. You gave us a lot of different ideas. You wanted things to work. And the quote that we chose, Neil, what was it?
The quote that we chose, Scott, was the Margaret Mead quote, actually.
Oh, well.
Yeah. It was a good choice. So, never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world. Indeed, it's the only thing that ever has.
Mm. Yeah. Why did you pick that quote?
Well, you know, it was sort of a mission statement for us in a way. You know, we, as Lynn knows our history, you know, we, as my shitty little career was launching, I had gotten to write some movies that nobody was making. But I've written some with some really good people. I'd broken in with after 12 years of bartending and aspiring to write, I finally, you know, sold a project to Ray Liotta's company that never got made, which got me to Ron Howard's company. The movie never got made. And then my wife and I got married and had our first child in Shane, who was born profoundly disabled with this disability called spinal muscular atrophy, which essentially left him paralyzed from about mid-face down. So it was like, you know, the best day of our lives became the worst day of our lives. And dealing with the shock, the doctors, well, before they had diagnosed him with SMA, said the best case scenario is you're going to be raising him in a wheelchair. And my niece, little Dorothy at the time, was probably 7 or 8. She said, well, what's the big deal? We'll just build ramps everywhere.
Nice.
It sort of struck a chord with us. And in the process of figuring out a way to build ramps everywhere, basically, to, one, ramp up my game career-wise, because I was going to have to pay for this child's health and also retrofitting our house with ramps everywhere. We also looked into, you know, the state of disability in this country and around the world. And there was a thing called the Americans with Disabilities Act, which was wonderful. It's the reason why you have, ramps at your corners on the streets, and you have those big toilet stalls at the airport. But in the area, one thing we discovered was in the area of playgrounds, what you had was a cement ramp leading to a sand moat or wood chips with play equipment inside. So one thing we discovered was there'd be this glaring inequity in terms of raising a child with a disability. Now, sorry to say that Shane only lived 2 weeks. We had to take him off the respirator at 2 weeks. He was weakening. But in the midst of our grief, the year after was a bit of a fog. Oddly enough, I had said to my sister who'd flown out here, I'd said to her and a buddy of mine, I said, man, I gotta figure out a way to up my game career-wise because as I said, I got to pay for all this this care that Shane will need. And like a day or two later, my agent called and said, look, I know you're going through a terrible time, but don't ask me how, but Stephen Bochco at NYPD Blue got a hold of your Ray Liotta script and wants you to write television. So it was weird. Like I sort of put out that I needed something in the universe. And then this sort of showed up at this very strange time. And obviously I said, well, tell him, I don't know when I'll get to meet with him. And it was the last thing I was thinking about was what this would bring that way. After losing Shane, we had gone through this whirlwind year where I was working my first year on a television show and it was affording us a different lifestyle. It paid off a lot of debt. But also we had Shane's empty bedroom and we had, my grieving wife, both of us were grieving, but you know, she had suffered a couple of miscarriages after that when we were trying to make up for our loss. And then he decided about a year in to give her body and our minds a rest. And we started this thing called Shane's Inspiration, which was we made it our mission to build a playground, one playground in Los Angeles that would, allow children with disabilities to play with able-bodied kids. It wasn't about a park for disabled kids. It was an actual, you know, a park where every kid could play. Nobody was left out. Complete inclusion. Inclusion was the big word. I, being something of a cynic, was not sure. I said, well, we don't, you know, of course I would love to do this, but you know, we don't know anything about playgrounds and you know, how will we sell this? Well, one of the things when you lose a child, everyone, you know, says, what can I do? What can I do? Right. And there's nothing that anyone can do to help in that situation. When you decide to build a playground in memory of your lost son, everybody shows up. So
right.
This small band of committed citizens showed up to affect change in the world or to help us affect change in the world or at least affect change in Los Angeles at that time. And it really, I forgot what came first, whether we saw the quote first and the other followed or in the midst of building this thing. And it wasn't, you know, it wasn't an easy sell. There were definitely people on city council that were like, I never see kids with disabilities at playgrounds. Is this really necessary? And I'm like, well, no shit. Cause they get to go and watch other kids play. It's no fun, you know?
Yeah.
So, you know, we ran into some of those obstacles, people that were just a little older in their, you know, a more old fashioned in their thinking. But you know, by and large, it's a difficult thing for anyone to be against, you know, regardless of your political party or your faith or whatever. No one's really against kids playing in a playground. Right. So,
very bipartisan, I would think.
Yeah, very bipartisan, yeah. So, you know, the Margaret Mead quote is actually, you know, we opened it. It took us 2 years. We got the city to donate the land. They donated a very large tract of 2 acres that we then had to fill. We raised, you know, $2 million some dollars, I think, in that time and built the first, you know, the playground, wheelchair playable and crutches and every other disability. We put things in there. You know, we have apparatus in there for, you know, kids with autism, kids with Down syndrome, blind, you know, hearing impaired. There's Braille features on the playground. And and that quote, you know, we put in bronze on a plaque and it sits on a rock in the playground because it's a way of just thanking the small band of committed citizens who did this. Now, what we didn't anticipate was I was like, yay, we built a playground. We're done, you know.
Done.
But, then we had a family from West LA that said, gee, our son Aiden loves this place. It's the only place where he can come and play with his brothers. He's profoundly disabled in a wheelchair and has two able-bodied brothers. They come and they get to push him around in a wheelchair and they run around. But the drive from West LA here, at rush hour is very taxing. Is there a way that we get one of these in our neighborhood? Now, we had completely tapped our friends out of every like nickel and dime, you know, like if we built it on $5 donations, $50 donations, very grassroots. We had a few corporate sponsors that came in toward the end that helped us put it over the hump. But thankfully, this family, the Gaffney family, wonderful people, they showed up with their own friends with money. And wow. So we said, well, we've hit up everybody we know. Can we, you know, we'll help you build yours. And we did. A year later, we managed to raise the money quickly because they had friends. And we built it in. We replaced the playground in West LA and now called Aiden's Place. Was playground number two.
Yeah.
And then, like, you know, our mission kind of grew a little bit. Now Maria Shriver was showing up to help cut the ribbon, and it was like starting to kind of gain some traction. Well, you know, here we are. Shane would now be 24, and we're at 72 or 3 plus parks, I think.
Wow.
Around the country and globally. We've gotten in Canada, in South America, in Israel, in Sochi, Russia, with the Olympics that were there a few years ago. They built one. But we don't talk about Russia right now.
No,
but,
I'll cut that bit out.
Yeah, right, exactly. I don't celebrate that one quite as much as I used to.
Yeah.
But at any rate, you know, again, Lynn knows I'm a big Springsteen fan. You know, from small things, mama, big things one day come. You know, it was really one of those things that demonstrated to us that from a simple one idea one day to like do something to help us heal, it accomplished that and then so much more. And so, you know, getting to watch kids play at these things, and oddly enough, also getting to watch what we really didn't expect was there was an old man at our playground who was in a wheelchair, and he was rolling his wheelchair around, chasing his grandkids on our structures. It's like these things.
Oh,
and, he came down, and he was all out of breath, and he just goes, I got to tell you, he goes, I was paralyzed in a car accident at 17. He goes, I could never take my kids to the playground, and now I can take my grandkids.
Oh, wow. So it works the other way around. Yeah. Disabled family members can play with their kids. It's amazing.
Yeah.
We didn't think about that. It was like, you know, so that's why the Mead quote will always be, you know, near and dear to my heart. We've changed the name of the mission. We've expanded it. The organization is now called Inclusion Matters by Shane's Inspiration, and it's at inclusionmatters.org. But, you know, they continue to do great work. You know, my wife and I are less involved on the day-to-day and serve more as ambassadors to it because it's really taken on a life of its own, the mission. So, but honestly, that, you know, it goes hand in hand with, you know, with Hillary's, it takes a village, you know, it really, that Margaret Mead quote means a lot to us because it's proof in the pudding, because there's a lot of people that think, what can me and my neighbors do about this situation? What can we, how can we help the world? But it's like, you know, in small ways, you help, someone said it, you know, you help one, you help a million, you know, so. Lynn knows my wife is a slacker.
Your wife is totally not a slacker. Your wife is a dynamo. Like, literally, when she picks something up and she is on it, man.
Was my sarcasm?
She's not here to defend herself, so.
No, listen, the worst thing you could tell my wife is no, because that means it's going to happen. She's just like,
we were talking about this the other week. She's one of these get shit done women, right? That's what you're saying.
Totally, exactly right. Get shit done. She's a manifester. Yeah. You know, I made the mistake at our previous house, and I'm like, I wish I had like 1 foot of closet space more, which I was thinking, I'm going to knock this wall out and maybe, you know, do. Next thing I know, we're like searching for a new house and we're building a new house and Lynn's building a new house, you know. And I'm like, whoa, whoa, slow down, slow down. Like, you got to be careful what I say around her because she'll make it happen, you know.
Yeah.
And like I said, no, I was the cynic going like, can we do this? And she was like, yeah, yeah, just come with me and take the ride. And again, it was so grassroots. I mean, we drafted her friend Tiffany. And so basically, we started off, all of our events included, like, me and Tiffany's husband, Quint, like loading and unloading trucks at our 5Ks and 10Ks and, you know, doing all the work ourselves. We really, you know, every dollar that we raised went to the cause, not to some production team that was going to help us make our gala look cool. Like, no, we were there folding napkins and getting things, you know, but it's like, honestly, it was super healing and remains super healing. And, and again, you just, especially the time when you just, the world seems so screwed up and
be involved in something that it's just, you know, is giving good and doing good in the world.
Yeah. And you also, you just discover that there's just a lot of really good people in the world that, it's like people at their core are nice and good and mean well and want to help. You know, it's like what gets attention is negativity, you know,
totally.
The louder person that's pointing at the people who are this is your problem. It's those people.
Yeah.
They get the airtime. They're a circus, a sideshow, but it's like, on the whole, and unfortunately what doesn't get enough airtime because it's not as interesting. You know, I think I was just talking to a friend the other day about, you know, a bunch of college friends and I were getting together on a Zoom and we hadn't, a lot of us hadn't seen each other in 30 some years. And we were like, you know, let's all like use these next few Zooms to like tell our stories, you know? And we have one friend who's a great guy, but he basically told us all about all of his successes. And I'm this, and I did that, and then I did this, and I did this. Yeah. And he's a, you know, my college happened to be big on physical education. So a lot of these, you know, about half the guys are into like coaching. They coach sports, you know, different kinds. Mm. So he's telling us about all the amazing people that he met and all this great things. And I got to say, it was like the least compelling story. And I told him so because honestly, because everybody else got to tell the story. I got to talk about Shane.
Yeah.
And I got to talk about the jobs I didn't get and the bumps in the road in our marriage that we overcame. Mm. You know, it's like, and so that's what I want to hear. I don't want to hear, I'm the greatest, I build the tallest
the
building,
blaster.
Look at
me,
you know. I want to hear about, you know, we had hard times and we overcame it and we didn't do it alone. It took a small band of committed citizens to help pull us through that.
Yeah.
We all hate asking for help, but we love giving it. When we're asked for help, it's like, what, I can be of use for someone, you know?
Yeah.
So I just discovered that, you know, it's as hard as it was to ask for help. People were really excited and eager to give it.
To give, yeah.
Yeah. Mm. It's stingy to not accept goodness. You know, like my mother went through this thing with my grandmother years ago. My mother, grandmother would like send us, you know, send her $50 for her birthday. And she'd like give her back for her birthday, her own $50 check and like another $50 check. And I'm like, What the fuck? Yeah. And she goes, what? I just wanted to know. Like, like, no, you're being stingy. You're not giving her the joy of giving to you. Let her give to you, you know. So.
But your mother is Scottish, though.
But that's, I mean, don't get me started on a whole Scottish thing. That's a whole Edinburgh thing.
Right?
That's the nobility of poverty, you know. That's a whole other conversation.
Yeah. Hey, one of the things I'd say about you is how you and Catherine both actually, manage to create family where you go. You have like it's like family groups in a way, you know, like the Shane's people are very close, and also when we moved over here, you and Catherine were very welcoming. It was like, come into the family, right?
Oh, you're the same type person though. I mean, honestly, it's we love being pulled into communities and we love pulling people into ours and all that, but yeah, again, same thing. It's very easy for us to isolate, you know,
totally.
And especially after the forced isolation of the last couple of years. Mm. I'll have days where, you know, Grace now lives in Baltimore with her boyfriend. I don't know if you know that, Lynn. Yeah, so she left there to go to school, and she took some time off, and now she lives with her boyfriend and works in Baltimore. And so she's gone. you know, we're in her life every day thanks to the cell phone, you know.
Grace is your daughter. We should say that because we hadn't mentioned her yet.
Grace is Shane's sister, who was born 3 years later, and she is healthy and wonderful, and we're grateful for her.
Beautiful
and,
girl, actually.
Yeah. The teenage years nearly killed us, but besides that.
yeah. That happens to all of us.
Yeah. But there are days, in terms of isolation, I'm saying there are days that, like, you know, so Catherine's out, Grayson's away, the dog's not talking to me. It's like, I'll go to Gelson's just to say hi to the cashier, just to, like, engage.
Now you have me as a neighbor, so we can get her for a coffee.
Where are we meeting? What's the local? We'll go to Pat's for a drink.
Sometime, yeah, Pat's or Harvest Moon.
Harvest Moon. There you go.
Yeah. There's many things that I love about NCIS, actually. It keeps the drama for the screen. That's what I like.
Yeah, very
you
much.
You know, like, the drama with NCIS is in the show. It's not around the show. There's You know what I mean? It seems like everybody just gets on and they do the thing.
There's no diva-like behavior at all. I joined in season 9 and I had worked a season at Castle, which was another great show, and got along great there. But then I got this really good offer from a friend that I had worked, I'm dropping show names now, a buddy of mine that I had worked with a few years before on Bones. I don't even remember Bones.
I remember writing Bones.
So Gary Glassberg called me up and goes, hey, I have an opening. You know, I'm running the NCIS now. I have an opening. Can you come here? And he gave me a really good offer. But I was like, I don't know shit about Navy. You know, it's like, I wasn't in the military or anything. And he goes, oh, it's a cop show with heart and jokes. It's what we do, you know. Because if you watch Bones, Castle, and NCIS, they're also similar in tone in that they have, you know, we're solving crimes, but we're like, you know, they don't take themselves too seriously. They crack jokes, and there's a lot of heart moments. And if you can laugh and cry within an hour, you've done your job. But I went to Nathan Fillion, who plays Castle, and said, "Hey, dude, I'm leaving." He said, "Why? What are you doing?" I said, "Well, I got an offer from NCIS." He goes, "Oh, I hear that's the best gig in town." He says, all my friends who work there, who have been like guest stars there, like never want to leave. Apparently, like Mark Harmon's the coolest. And I got to say, I showed up and I had my first lunch with Mark and I thought I was being punked because he was like, he was so nice and so welcoming.
You're like, what's the catch?
Yeah. And so when Lynn talks about no drama around the show, it all kind of trickles down from the top with that guy in that, you know, he was a quarterback, a star quarterback at UCLA. And he's sort of the quarterback of this show. In that all the good, and again, you'll find this on a lot of shows. If you're number one on the call sheet's an asshole, there's going to be kind of a hard time. If you're number one on the call sheet's really cool, you know, it's going to trickle down to the rest of the crew. It's the one time where trickle down actually does apply. So really it all starts with Mark. And so for 10 years now that I've been on the show, Mark's been the quarterback and just been a dream. And when we break for lunch pre-pandemic, you know, actors don't cut in the lunch line to get preferential treatment. They wait behind. I'll never forget, we had Lily Tomlin on my first year as a guest star. And he grabbed her by the elbow and said, sorry, Lily, you can wait back here with me. And he like pulled her to the back of the lunch line behind all the crew members waiting at the food truck to get food. And she was like, oh, that's cool. Okay. Well, she didn't give a shit. She's no prima donna either, but she was just used to on other shows, actors taking their place. So Mark's very... very socialist in that regard and just like, no, we're just like everybody else. We're all just workers. And then losing him this year, you know, he decided after 19 seasons to hang it up and not to say we won't get him back as a guest star in some regard if we can coax him out of, you know, he's not in retirement. He's got other projects going on, but and somehow we've survived. We've survived losses of other characters too, but we all thought when we lose Harmon, we're going to be sunk. But our numbers, knock wood, have hung on there. So, you know, we're just going to keep going.
Can I ask a question, Scott?
Sure.
Obviously, I've been looking at your career. So you started writing. So what's the link? How come it seems that everything you've worked in, you've produced, you've written, there's all the cop stuff. There's all, what's the link?
It's all crime.
It's all crime and people dying and, you know.
Neil, I'm very limited. That's why.
Rubbish. Don't even try that, Williams.
I want to know where it came from, Scott.
Neil, I've been recycling the same script for 25 years. It's
still not been found out, right?
That's not true. Don't even try it, Williams.
No, you know, I think I tended bar for 12 years. You've heard of 12 years a slave? I was 12 years a bartender. Yeah. So from college to New York to Los Angeles, as I aspired to be an actor early in my career, then that kind of gave way to the writing. I was such a good actor, I'm a writer now. But, you know, as a bartender, I got to know, and a lot of my friends were law enforcement. So I got to, you know, we had a lot of detectives and cops coming into the bar that I'd get to know. I went to a school that was big on physical education. Like I said, a lot of my friends are coaches, but a lot of them also, like, you know, went into become firemen or cops. Mm. And going hand in hand with that also, you know, there's a criminal element. I know quite a few people growing up, and as, you know, Lynn, you're a criminal element. You're a Glaswegian. You know a few, yeah.
Colorful people. We call them colorful. Nefarious. Translated
as I've been in prison a lot. Okay, yeah, I get it.
Exactly. So I've always loved that fine line. Growing up, the kids that were the troublemakers in our neighborhood were the cops kids. You know, they would get out of trouble all the time.
So you write what you know.
Yeah, so I was always very sort of intoxicated by it, and it's always sort of what I gravitated towards. And then the script that got me an agent finally after years of trying and hearing no was a script I wrote about a personal experience that a friend of mine had witnessed a murder at a bar that he was working in an after-hours club among mob guys. So I wrote this sort of like mob movie, and the cops trying to investigate the thing. So, and it led to a job with Ray Liotta, I think I mentioned earlier, the movie that never got made, but about crooked cops. And that was the one that made David Milch at NYPD Blue go, hey, you should write TV. So I just sort of found the niche of cop stories, because they're sort of like, they're like wise guys or mob guys for the cause of justice, you know, or something. I don't know. So I always kind of like that. And again, I have a soft spot, just as big a soft spot for the criminal element, frankly, also. So I kind of like exploring
you
both.
You bite us round, right?
Which is why 10 minutes into hearing your podcast, I went, oh, yeah, I know these. Yeah, okay. Does that answer your question, Neil? I think that's
yes,
about
it. Does.
Yeah,
yeah,
pretty much.
What I was going to say is normally we do this thing, right? We normally do a thing where Chesney does music, Neil does like all the technical sound wiseness, and I do story, right? Which is
You're
that
very
I would
good.
Read a little. So thanks very much. Normally, I'll ask you a question and then I'll read a little into your story. But I think you're very open, and so what I'm thinking would be good in this place is Neil is a very prepared individual. Like, he doesn't look like that by looking at him, but he's a very prepared individual. And he said earlier on, he said, "You know how Scott used to be a barman? Do you think he'd be prepared to do a quiz on how to make certain cocktails and bar work?"
Oh, Jesus.
And I was like, yeah,
did you fit
there
back
is
into
no
it, Scott?
Better way to do authenticity. So are you ready to do the bar?
We're putting it on you, I'm afraid, Scott.
You know, I honestly, people ask me if I know how to make these fancy cocktails, you know, because now they're what? They're these incredible bartenders of these recipes. In my day, it was like gin and tonic, scotch and soda, you know, like, but give me a try. Occasionally,
he's prepared it, Scott. He prepared it.
We thought, how many can you get in 45 seconds?
Oh, I'm excited. Yes. Oh, my God.
Yes.
This
it's
is
great.
Why people come on our show, right? This is it.
This is our first ever quiz, by the way, Scott.
First ever.
Really?
Yeah.
I'm so excited.
Oh, God.
I hope I at least get half of these right.
Both of us don't. No pressure.
I wish we were drinking right now. It's 10 in the morning here, but yeah. Go ahead.
Okay, Scott Williams, stand by. Are you ready?
Take it away, Quizmaster.
Here we go. Screwdrivers include what fruit juice?
Orange juice.
Yes, correct.
Ding.
Which liquor is used to make a Bloody Mary?
Well, liquor, vodka, and tomato juice.
Thank you very much.
Ding.
Which of these cocktails could be ordered dry or dirty? Americano, martini, Manhattan, or old-fashioned?
Martini.
Of course it could be.
Ding.
Which cocktail is made of these ingredients? Vodka, triple sec, cranberry juice, and lime juice? Mojito, painkiller, blue basil, or cosmopolitan?
Cosmo. Is that
ding,
right?
Ding, 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 ding.
Yeah.
You got them all right.
Woo,
let's
let's
try
go,
another one.
You
got one, two,
you
three,
did 12 years
four.
Of art.
Yeah.
So, you know,
one,
what
two,
do you expect?
Three, four. Yeah, you got four right. So there you go. Four
I was worried
seconds.
You were going to give me like, hey, can you make me a slippery monkey, you know, or whatever those, like, you know.
We're really not that intelligent, clever, or about slippery nipples either.
We get like, hey, man, can you make me a fuzzy nipple? And I'd be like, go back to your TGI Fridays in Passaic, New Jersey, and order your local...
What happened to TGI Fridays? God, that was the 80s wrapped up.
Remember
in
that?
Bun,
yes,
it,
that was when I was working. And we'd get what we call the bridge and tunnel crowd. We'd get kids from Long Island or New Jersey coming into the town, and they'd ask
sex
for
the
like
beach,
their local
something.
Beverage, sex on the beach or whatever. That, those I kind of learned, you know.
Yeah.
But Long Island iced teas and those things. But Oh, that was exciting. Good. I'm nervous. I watch the kids. I watch the bartenders now with these craft guys with their handlebar mustaches putting like egg whites on top of things. I'm like, I have no idea what you're doing.
I thought handlebar mustaches, I thought that was either coffee guys or barbers these days.
No. I don't know, Lynn. Have you been in the local restaurants? They're all kind of, you know.
Especially the women. They've got the big mustaches.
A lot of designer beards within the women bartenders.
You're very generous of spirit, and also I think you are like 100% honest. What would you say to somebody who's not necessarily bartending right now? Because I think that like you really enjoyed bartending, even though it wasn't your big plan, right? That what would you say to somebody who would like, not your career, but would like to be a writer, and like to make their life as a writer, but aren't they a writer?
You know, I will say I loved bartending in my 20s. By my 30s, I was like, oh my God, I have to get a life. Yeah, every bartending shift I had, yes, I was like making lots of money and meeting girls and, you know, getting loaded half the time. But like, I also would have dropped it all had I, you know, gotten a yes at an audition and been, you know, my career is made. But I had the disadvantage of when I landed on Columbus Avenue on the west side of Manhattan, Bruce Willis had just left his bartending gig up the street at Cafe Central to go take the job on Moonlighting,
and then do
Die Hard. So, you know, everybody was like, "Hey, man, Bruno, you know Bruno up the street? Yeah, he just scored." Like literally the day I started, they were like, "Bruno up the street got a job on," and I'm like, "Okay, all right, I'm gonna go that way." And then Bruce Willis became this giant star. Every Manhattan bartender at that point was like, I'm up next, you know, I call next, you know. But also with bartending too, when David Milch gave me my first job, you know, on NYPD Blue, he said, "I like your writing, fine. I like the fact that you tended bar for 12 years even more." So like the job that I had a love-hate relationship with all those years actually gave me characters and gave me, I got to see people at their best and their worst, and I got to write about, and I still access that bank of people that I, you know, that I remember from those years and then since. And I often tell aspiring writers that, you know, there are no shit jobs. Like whether if you're making French fries at McDonald's, pay attention and focus, because you'll one day be writing the story of the French fry maker who saved the world, and you'll have personal experience to draw upon. I get crazy. You know, John Boehner, the Speaker of the House back in the Obama years, you know, he's such an asshole. Yeah. He said when he accepted the speakership, you remember he was like big on crying. I don't know if you guys recall, but he was a big crier.
Yeah.
When I think back to all the crap jobs I had coming up, and now I'm the Speaker of the House. And I was like, you moron, you are speaking like your constituents, the people you claim to represent, have those crap jobs. Like, were those jobs beneath you and now you've arrived where you should be all along? It's like, there are no crap jobs, man. Like, it's like everything's an experience and fodder material for your later life and for, you know, life experience or experience that you're going to put on a page and become a writer with. So I always just say, you know, you've got to pay your rent. A lot of writing, you know, isn't necessarily typing words on a page, because you've got to spend all kinds of time staring out windows and thinking of how a scene will go down before you begin to put it to the page. So, you know, but a lot of writers beat themselves up if they don't get, if they get a half a page written that day. It's a discipline like anything else. And you know, Lynn, you're a writer. I don't know if Ches and Neil go that way, but it's like, you know, it's hard. I hate to make what I do sound like hard, but it's hard, you know, and not everybody can do it.
Yeah.
And I think there's some talent involved, but moreover than that, there's like, just like elbow grease involved. Yeah. I mispronounce the word all the time, but there's some word like that someone said early in my career, Sitzfleisch. It's some German name or something. It basically means like sit your flesh in your seat and get it written, you know.
Right.
Do it.
Right.
So don't get it right, get it written. There's all kinds of axioms like that, you know. But, you know.
I have a question for you, Scott. Because you work in TV and there's probably a lot of deadlines and you've always got something to write, are there passion projects that you've had over the years that you haven't been able to get to? And maybe through the pandemic, did you get to anything like
that? Yeah, that's a great question. I mean, deadlines are your friend, because I have been guilty of, and I have friends that if I am writing some passion project on the side, unless I have a deadline, it's like I could be writing this thing for 10 years. You know what I mean?
Absolutely.
It's the whole, there's some line in Animal House of like, I've been working on my novel for 5 years. It goes, oh, it must be very good. No, it's a piece of shit. You know, it's like, it's that whole. But if I have a deadline, you know, people will say, how long does it take you to write a script? I'll say, how long do I have? Like, if you give me 2 weeks, it's like, I'll bang it out in 2 weeks. If you give me a year, you know, that's it's going to meander a bit before I get it to where I like it. I have the blessing of working on a show and having worked on multiple shows now that have a world already sort of created that I can kind of write into and characters that already have a voice that I can mimic, that I can conjure and mimic their voices. But in terms of features, I've only had two features made. One went straight to video and one I completely lost credit on because it was a biography and it was a sports biography that got rewritten a million times and partially fictionalized and I kind of lost it. But
that's Hollywood for you.
You know, that's why I stick with television, right? Because it's like, but movies are like, you have a better chance of being struck by lightning, despite the crap you see, the glut of material.
Choice on you have,
I used to say, when you walk through Blockbuster, you're like, where do these movies come from? You know, how come no one's making my movie? By the way, one of the coolest, it's like one of the greatest benefits of this podcast that you guys have, Chez, do this for people.
Right?
This is
wonderful. Lynn and I are filler, you know, basically. We're filler.
We're hanging on his shirt tails, and I mean,
the opportunity for Chez to sing a favorite song. It's wonderful. It's beautiful.
Yeah, right. Utilizing for all sorts of things.
Yeah.
I've loved it, Scott. You know, this is for me, like, I've discovered all sorts of music and managed to kind of, like, you know, record and play with artists that I would maybe not have even discovered sometimes, you know.
Right.
So for our listener, just so to, so they're up to date, every week we have our lovely guest choose a song for us, and then I make a version of that song as a gift for our guest. So Scott gave us all sorts of songs to choose from.
I gave choices out of panic, I think, on both the sayings and the songs, because, you know, none of us want to be pigeonholed as one thing.
No.
You know, I don't want to be like, our lips are sealed by the Go-Go's, and have everyone go,
oh, yeah, yeah.
It's the Go-Go guy.
Oh, I wish you'd chosen our lips are sealed by the
Go-Go's.
No, you know, though, the thing is you don't have
to worry
about being...
It's a great song, But people can judge you on one song.
They can.
You're going to be pigeonholed by being the
exactly.
No, but you will be by being the nice guy. By being the proof that there are nice guys existing, you will be pigeonholed by that. That's it.
Well, that's a good hole to be pigeoned into. I'm fine.
Right. Well, I actually, for one, was very grateful for a list of songs because I don't normally get that choice, you know.
No.
For me, because a lot of times the songs,
I
just
email,
think, oh, what?
That's it, isn't it?
How the fuck am I going
to
do?
To sing Our Lips Are Sealed by the Go-Go's? You are.
Funny you should say that.
Oh, geez. Yes. That's what I'm going to do. No, actually, if you don't mind, I'll actually read all of your song choices and then I'll tell you which one I did. So,
okay.
So you said earlier on that you're a Springsteen fan, Thunder Road, which I absolutely love, beautiful song. Jackson Browne, another incredible artist, Your Bright Baby Blues. Free Man in Paris by Joni Mitchell. Beautiful. I actually introduced that song to my daughter yesterday because she's going to Paris in a couple of days.
Oh, wonderful.
And so I said, you have to listen to that song. And there was two that I really was like, oh, yeah, that's me all over. The first one was XTC, Mayor of Simpleton, which I just, you know, who doesn't love XTC?
Yeah. I knew you Brits would get hooked by that one, yeah.
Oh, well, of course. I mean, I took a while to choose, you know, but in the end, I plumbed for Van Morrison's Into the Mystic.
Nice.
Because I'm such a Van fan, and I love his soul, his gypsy soul.
Yeah.
So that was the song we went for. Into the Mystic by Van Morrison.
Thrilling.
Okay, well, just for you then, Scott Williams. Not that one. By the wonders of technology. Here we have Chesney Hawkes performing Into the Mystic.
We were born into the wind, also younger than the sun. Here the bunny boat was won as we sailed into the mystic. Hark now, hear the sailors cry. Smell the sea and feel the sky. Let your soul and spirits fly into the mystic. When that foghorn blows, will be coming home. And when that foghorn blows, I wanna hear it. I don't have to fear it. I wanna rock your gypsy soul, just like way back in the days of old. Ooh. Then magnificently we will float into the mystic. Together we will float into the mist.
Scott Williams, that was Chesney.
Wow.
Performing Van Morrison's Into the Mystic. Well done, Ches. Smashed it.
Ches,
again,
you are, that is a gift, man. You are gifted. That is really beautiful. And I wondered how you were going to handle those horns, and your vocals are spectacular right there. Beautiful.
Right?
Thank you, guys. Thank you so much. Yeah, I always try and keep the recording of it very simple, just guitar and vocal or whatever. So, you know, I couldn't get the horn section in for that, so I just sing it, you know.
As the horns approached, I kind of thought, I wonder how he's going to do that. And then there is your beautiful vocal. I'm like, oh, like that. Okay, that covers it beautifully. That's great. Yeah. And nice guitar work as well. Beautiful.
Why, thank you.
Tell us about that song, Scott. Why, what is it? Does it give you any particular memories, or why is that one hold such a special place?
You know, it's a couple things. I think it's a high school, or friends and I would go to a bar and you know, underage drink beer, and the jukebox had Moondance on side A, and that song on side B, and it takes me back to that place. And I remember I was just discovering him at that point. Mm-hmm. And also too, I just consider it such a beautiful song. It sounds morose to say, but it's one of those, it's like, yeah, play that at my funeral. That's like such a great,
right.
Mm-hmm. Such a beautiful song. Send me off into the mystic to that song.
Oh, that's great.
And yeah. I've seen Van a few times, you know, and he's an interesting cat, because he's not a faithful concertier, you know. He'll give a jazz version of things, and he can be curmudgeonly and all that stuff. But
there's great stories about Van in those ways. Like I've heard that he's done gigs literally facing away from the crowd.
Yeah.
He doesn't even show his face sometimes.
Yeah. Oh no. Yeah. I mean, he does everything but a big middle finger on his back, you know, just to say all of you. Yeah. But that said, it's like there's no voice like his, there's no writer like him, and you know, he's incredible. Yeah. You know, he's definitely
unique for sure.
So that's I love lots of Van songs, but that one definitely is probably my number one.
Well, actually we should probably close now. Scott Williams, every time I meet you I like you more. And I don't really know how that happens, because already, like, I was going to the guys, oh, we've got to have Scott Williams, you'll love him, he's lovely. And then I meet you and I'm like, God, he really is lovely. So thank you so much for doing this.
Right back at you on all counts, Lynn. Mm-hmm. And Ches and Neil, too, thank you just for having me. I was delighted to get the invitation. I'm like, you know, what? Human contact? Yes, please. Yes. Sign me up. Yes, please.
And we'll definitely get that slippery nipple at the thirsty merchant.
Absolutely. I'm going to New York. My wife and I are going to Baltimore to visit my daughter, and then to New York in for much of May. But I'll be back in June, so we'll do it then.
Big love to your missus.
Thank you, and to your mister and Neil, and thank you so much, Ches. And listen, we'll all get together at some point. Neil, I don't know when I'm in the UK next, but
yeah, absolutely. Thank you so much for making the time for us. We really appreciate it. Scott Williams on our podcast.
Scott.
Everybody,
whoa,
big
we love you.
Love you back. Thank you for having
me. Thank you, Scott.
How much do you love him, Scott Williams? I told you.
You were right, Lynn. You were right. I was sceptical, but you were right.
Adorable and sceptical. Sceptical yes. And adorable, but right.
What a lovely man. And he's my neighbourino.
There you go.
I know, right?
Yeah, you can go and have a couple of sherries together.
He's going to be my friend too.
Yeah, well.
But it was an interesting thing. So, Lynn, you observed the fact that we asked him for a quote and he gave us a list of quotes. So, you know, it was an interesting observation about the sort of person he is and a generous man. And the other thing that I read into that was it was the other quotes as well. I thought when I started reading the other quotes, it was... we won't go into them all now, just one of the other short ones. The sign of a first-rate mind is the ability to have two opposite opinions at the same time, F. Scott Fitzgerald. Mm. But I thought, wow, when I read these quotes, I'm like, wow, this guy's a doer. This is a guy that does stuff. He is
Look what he's done.
Exactly. Yeah. And then of course, we got a window into his soft side because he then sort of gave us a couple of quotes which were from songs. And there's that lovely one from The Who song, I'd gladly lose me to find you. So he's obviously got that loving, soft side. But yeah, what he does with Shane's inspiration and his other charity is We Spark, which is about care for cancer patients.
Oh wow, we didn't mention that. It's good that we mentioned that.
I mean, it's just incredible. It really is. What he does and what he's done, amazing.
See, I think that I think his strong side and his soft side are the same.
Right.
I think I think that what makes him so strong is that he's not afraid to be soft. That if you ask him a question, he'll answer it honestly. He doesn't put on some kind of "I'm a very important man" for him.
No, very true.
Right? No, he's just like totally straight up who he is. Yeah, I love him. I don't have anything else to say really because I haven't learned that I love him more. Except I just love him. I think he's like. I'm very glad he did our podcast.
Yeah, thank you for bringing him on, Lynn, and introducing us.
I think we live in a world at the moment where we are often led to believe that people who have power don't seem to have any integrity.
Yeah, what we expect.
And what
isn't it?
He is such a good reminder of is that power and integrity can and do go hand in hand.
And it sounds like the same thing with the big boss of NCIS. He sounds like a similar kind of character.
Mark Harmon seems to be a sweet guy.
Yeah.
But it's that old thing of like sort of. You know, you attract the right people, don't you? It's all that thing about the right energy attracting each other. And so it's probably no surprise that he's ended up working on that show, is it, really?
Yeah. Just a good guy. Yep. So, guys, are we finished for this week? Listener, I hope that you very much enjoyed it. We enjoyed having you here, listener.
Yes.
And we love doing this too,
we do, guys?
We really do.
Do you know what we have to be careful of, though?
What?
Because our listener possibly lives in the UK and there's been a lot of love. We love you guys. We think. And if I
oh
was a
God.
Listener... Right?
Oh! Oh my God, you're right? So great.
Yeah, so our listener, if you're in the UK, which you probably are, Chesney's mum, that we did actually have fun. We hope you've had fun. And we're back again soon with another guest and another quote and another song. Mm.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Perfectly summed up, Liz.
But until then, we have been Ferguson.
Harrington.
Hawks.
And we will see you soon.
See you next time, listener.
Bye,
Thank
listener.
You
very Bye, much. Mum. I'll call you later.
Bye.
Love you.
Bye.
Stop with the love thing. They're in the UK.
Oh, sorry. Sorry. You're all a bunch of Oh, sorry.
I'm glad I didn't stop recording and I've got that beautiful. There's a Christmas tape in one line. You've been listening to Ferguson Harrington Hawks with Lynn Ferguson, Neil Harrington and Chesney Hawks. Written and produced for Source Productions by, surprise, surprise, Lynn Ferguson, Neil Harrington and Chesney Hawks.